Father God, thank you for this preaching opportunity, dear God. Lord, have your way. Lord God, touch right now, Father God. Lord, preach. We understand and we know, Lord, that we've only made it here but by your grace and by your mercy, God. Lord, we thank you. We thank you for being so good, so kind, and so merciful unto us. And Lord, we thank you for what you're getting ready to do. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Before you take your seats, word of God will come from Hebrews 11 and 4. Hebrews 11 and 4. Hebrews chapter 11, verse number 4. Amen. And the word of God reads, by faith, Abel offered unto God a more excellent sacrifice than Cain, by which he obtained witness that he was righteous, God testifying of his gifts. And by it, he being dead, yet speaketh. Amen. I want you to grasp your neighbor by the hand. And I want you to look your neighbor in the face, and I want you to say, hi, neighbor.
Hi, neighbor.
And I want you to tell them these words. Neighbor.
Neighbor.
Oh, neighbor.
Oh, neighbor.
Today.
Today.
With the Lord's help.
With the Lord's help.
Our pastor.
Our pastor.
Will preach.
Will preach.
From the subject.
From the subject.
When worship.
When worship.
Has high quality.
Has high quality.
Amen. 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 Worship has high quality, high quality, high quality. I hear you, preacher. What do you mean, high quality? Worship is just worship.
Yeah, all right.
But the Bible says that Abel offered up unto God a more excellent sacrifice.
Well,
which means that God looks at not just whether you worship, but he looks at the quality of your worship.
All right.
When we look at this passage and we look at it, it's giving an account of Cain and Abel from the book of Genesis that we very well know of. And when we look at that passage and we look at what it's referencing to, it's referencing that the two are offering up something unto God. And how many of you know that when you offer up something to God, then that is worship?
Yeah.
When we look at that offering and we look at what Cain gave and we look at what Abel gave, they were showing forth unto God how they felt about him.
Yeah.
So we must understand that worship within itself shows forth that we feel a certain way about something or someone.
All right.
Well, if you will. Well, when we look at it, on yesterday.
All right.
And I found it rather intriguing. I saw individuals who rearranged their life to when their favorite team played.
All right, all
they
right.
made some changes and adjustments that cost them something,
right.
that took away their time,
yeah.
and caused them to put their care and attention on something that took a whole lot of work.
Come on now.
See, there are people, let me tell you, that have rearranged their pocketbook, rearranged their schedule to do things and to bring their attention towards some things that they love and that they cherish.
All right.
Well, I saw some individuals, one of the individuals, he had rearranged or he had remodeled the truck. Yeah, and he had that truck laid out. Yeah, he had a television in the truck. Yeah, he had his place to where he could put his goods and his cooked food, and he had all those things, and he had it shined up. And when his favorite team plays, he pulls it out and he tailgates hours and hours and hours and hours and hours before the game.
All right.
Wow, that's devotion and that's dedication.
All right.
But then I had to stop, y'all, and I had to take a look at the church.
Come on.
And I had to take a look at how we treat God and how we do what we do.
Come on.
When we come to church, we come as if we are doing God a favor because we showed up.
Yeah.
But I'm here to tell you, true worship is when you come here with God on your mind and you come here ready to give God the praise that He rightfully deserves. Yeah, yeah, yeah. I saw another individual. Lord have mercy. Saw another individual that, guess what? They were so superstitious to where, yeah, you saw the commercials, to where, yeah, one might leave the room and they feel as though when they leave the room, their favorite team scores a point. So they walk downstairs so that their team can score. Lord have mercy. And they operate off of superstitions as if they got control over what in the world is going to happen. Yeah, I heard there's a group of ladies in the room and they were rooting for their favorite team. And yeah, one of the ladies got up to go use the restroom. And when she came back, the opposing team had scored. And you know what the other two ladies said? Girl, you better sit down. You're not leaving no more. Because once you left, yeah, our team, yeah, was scored on. You gonna stay right there. Isn't it amazing how people can devote so much attention to some stuff, but yet us as Christians, we can't give God just a little bit of our time. And when we do, yes, Lord, it's a chore.
Come on, man.
But how many of you know what worship is when you enjoy doing what you're doing? Because you know what? Your worship has some value.
Oh, yes.
Jesus, worship, worship, worship. Worship. That was another young man that I watched, and he had this great big orange suit that he wears every single game that his favorite team plays, or every home game rather, and he puts that suit in the cleaners, y'all. Yeah, and he wears it every single home game, and he's known for his nice bright orange suit. Yeah, he puts it in the cleaners, he makes sure it's clean, he makes sure he got the accessories, he's got the hat, he's got the shoes to match, and yeah, he got his wardrobe straight, y'all. But let me tell you something, how many of you know that us as Christians ought to have that same attitude when we know we're going to see the man?
let's look at the text. Lord have mercy. Because I don't want y'all to blame me for not preaching the text. Yeah. I want y'all to leave so that when you go home and you can study and know what I preach in the text. Amen. Let's look at it. It says, By faith, Abel offered unto God a more excellent sacrifice than Cain. When we look at worship and when we look at all that is entailed in worship, we got to understand that worship requires sacrifice.
Amen.
Jesus, everybody say sacrifice.
Sacrifice.
Yeah, you might not want to do it, but you ought to do it. You ought to do it. See, worship is sacrificial. Let me show you what a sacrifice is. Sacrifice is this. When you have sacrifice, then you have something that you can consider a victim. Oh, watch me. I'm going somewhere with this. See, when you look at sacrifice, you must understand that something has to die.
Oh, Jesus.
Oh, y'all ain't with me. See, you got to understand, when you look at sacrifice, something has to be slain. Jesus. When we look at sacrifice, something has to be laid down. See, us as believers, we've got to understand, when we offer up sacrifice, it's as if we are victims expecting God to have mercy upon us. And we're offering up what it is that we have to offer up to Him so that He understands and knows that, God, I acknowledge you for who you are. Lord have mercy. You remember? Yeah, when they were going up to that mountain and Abraham was told, and he was willing to give it away and willing to allow it to die so that he can show forth his loyalty to God. Wow. We have to understand that true worship is sacrificial. And we must know and we must understand that when we look at worship, we've got to understand that many a times the reason why, Lord have mercy, that we can't worship on the level where God wants us to worship is because many a time we haven't died to self.
Amen.
Jesus.
All right.
Where you going with that, preacher? How many of you know that your problems, what you're going through, what it is that you might have had to encounter on your way here, the things that you might have went through throughout that week, guess what? You're going to have to let that stuff go and let that stuff die so that you can reflect and remember and put your focus on the one who can handle all that stuff you're worried about. Jesus. So when you give Him your true worship, then guess what? Your attention is not on you and what you didn't get and what you can't do and what somebody has done to you, but your attention is sacrificial, and guess what? Something got to die. Even if it's your selfish desires. You want to see worship go to another level? Guess what? Let's see some humble folk. Let's see some folk understanding and knowing that, guess what? A man who thinking of himself to be something, when he's nothing, he deceiving himself. Yeah, you want to see worship go to another level? Look at some people who gonna, guess what, understand that compared to an almighty God, guess what, I'm but a wretch. But thank God that He comes down and He sees about me when I ain't no good. Jesus. But guess what, something has got to die. So we gotta understand this. That by faith Abel offered unto God a more excellent sacrifice than Cain. Now, guess what? I want to look at that. See, when we look at that account in Genesis, it baffled my mind preachers don't touch on it very much. But when I read and when I looked at it and I realized what happened, Lord have mercy, I had to put myself in there to see if I was guilty of something that, yeah, Cain was guilty of. Let me show you what I'm talking about. Let's look at Genesis 4, 3 through 5. Look what it says. It says, and in the process, of the time, it came to pass that Cain brought an offering of the fruit of the ground to the Lord. Take note. I'm coming back. Abel also brought of the firstborn of his flock and of their fat. And the Lord respected Abel and the Lord and his offering, but he did not respect Cain and his offering. And Cain was very angry and his countenance fell.
Yeah.
Oh, Jesus.
Oh, yeah.
What we have to understand and look at, I realize upon reading the text where Cain fell short. Oh, Jesus. Watch. See, for Cain, it says that he brought an offering. He gave something. But look what it said about Abel. It says, also Abel brought of the firstborn of flock.
He didn't care about what.
See, here's the difference. Cain gave an offering. Abel gave the first fruit of his flock. See, you got to understand that Cain, he gave something, but Abel gave his best. Jesus. And the Lord, he respected Abel, but he did not respect Cain's offering.
All right.
You must understand and you must realize that even though we do something in the name of Jesus, if you will, that guess what? God is not necessarily just looking at the fact that you did it. But God is looking at whether or not you did it and you gave him your best.
All right.
You see, the first fruit says something. Watch me. First fruit says this. I ain't paid no bills yet.
Oh, Jesus.
I hadn't taken care of this thing yet. I hadn't fixed my car yet. I hadn't taken care of all this stuff yet. But Lord, you see, if you bring my tithes into the storehouse, then you'll pour me out a blessing that I won't have room enough to receive. God, I'm going to give you first, and I'm going to trust you with the rest. First fruit says trust. Says that, you cashed the check, got your nails done, got your hair done, and got your bling bling, and then decide on Sunday, I better give God something. But God wants our best. Jesus. But now, we got to understand, we can't make this all about money. Can't make this all about money, because we got to understand that anytime we speak on his behalf, anytime we do ministry, anytime we conduct business in his name, we are offering up a sacrifice. My Lord, and if we have something in our hands, and we have something that God has entrusted us with, then guess what? We, when we do what we do, are showing forth how much we feel about it.
All right.
When we look at our ministries, what are we giving God? Jesus, what are we giving to God? Now, I'm going to tell you right now, as your pastor, I love it. But they got some of y'all in here, God done put some stuff in you. But because you won't get involved, he can't get nothing out of you.
All right.
Jesus, how many of you understand that when God invests in you, he doesn't expect you to just sit down on it, but he wants you to use what he's put in you to glorify his name. Supposed to do as if you, it's as if you say, God, I don't care if you use me or not. But I'm here to tell you, I asked the Lord, and guess what? Sometimes you gotta be careful what you pray. 21. It says, I beseech you, therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God. Watch this. To present, watch your bodies a living sacrifice. Holy and acceptable unto God. Yeah, the conversations you have. Jesus, I knew I wasn't going to get no amen from that, but I'm going to preach on it. Oh, Jesus. I'm going to preach on it anyway. But you got to understand that when we look at worship, it's sacrificial. It's sacrificial. I'm going to move on. Oh, Jesus, this is good. My Lord, look what it says. It says, by which, check it out, he obtained witness that he was righteous. Everybody say righteous.
Righteous.
Check this out. The next thing you got to understand about when worship has high quality or when you worship, you got to understand that when you worship, you will be exposed. I knew, Lord. I knew it already. Lord, I'm going to do what you told me. Why? It will expose.
All right.
Now check it out. There's two ways this scripture could have read. Lord have mercy. It could have read this, by which he obtained witness that he wasn't righteous. Or it could have written, by which he obtained witness that he was righteous. But from what he did, he obtained, guess what? Righteousness. See, you got to understand that your worship is going to come to the surface one way or the other. Understand that what was in his heart, it surfaced and it came to the what? Outside, right. And it was on display.
Yeah,
all right. Paul was able to see it, and guess what? He was declared or looked upon as righteous because of the things that was in his heart.
All right.
Jesus. So you gotta understand that worship is exposing. Mm-hmm. See, there's many folk that can talk this and talk that and talk the other. Oh, I love the Lord. He heard my cry. Jesus. Hallelujah. Anyhow. But you got to understand that the Lord don't care about your lip service as much as he cares about what you got up on the inside of your heart.
All right.
And what's in your heart, guess what? It's going to come out. Oh, Jesus. What's in a man will come out. Oh, Jesus. So Abel, because of what was in his heart, guess what? He gave not just anything. He gave the first. He gave his best. He didn't give an offering. He gave the first fruit of his flock. He gave his best. Jesus. So we got to understand that by your worship, guess what? Your worship and what you do and what's in your heart, it will be exposed. And guess what? Someone's going to be able to say. And guess what? God will allow people to see it. Guess what? You can say that folk judging you and talking about you and why you worrying about me and why you worrying about this and why you worrying about that. But God has a way of exposing some stuff.
Yeah.
And guess what? You let folk know, guess what? Yeah, they talking that stuff. They ain't no good. Yeah, behind the scenes, they talking one thing, but guess what? They ain't about nothing behind this, in the forefront. So we got to understand that, guess what? When we look at it, guess what? God will expose our worship. Because if we're saying one thing and doing another, and it contradicts what we're saying, guess what? Oh, Jesus, there's going to be some conflict somewhere.
Yeah. All right.
So our worship will be exposed. Why? How do I know that? Because the writer says that because he gave a more excellent sacrifice, it says that, guess what? He obtained witness that he was what? Righteous. Wow. All right. So from what he did, from what was in his heart, from how he conducted himself, from his worship, guess what? On the outside, folk was able to say he was righteous.
Yes.
Jesus. So we got to understand that worship will be exposed. It will be exposed. And we got to understand that, guess what? If we say we love the Lord as much as we say we do, guess what? And we love the Lord at the quality level we say we do, guess what? testify. Preacher, what in the world do you mean by testify? That means that God spoke well of him.
Mm. Amen.
That God said that what he had done was pleasing. Mm-hmm. That what he had done was good. See, we got to understand, when our worship is at a high quality level, then guess what? It will be praise worthy. And we must understand that if we want God to shine down upon us, guess what? We're going to have to raise the bar.
All right.
We're going to have to do things a little bit better. All right. And we're going to have to allow God to use us in such a way to where, guess what, Lord, whatever way you want to use me, Lord, use me up.
All right. All right.
His worship was praise worthy. And guess what? He didn't have to wait on other folk to do it. God said that his praise, or that his offering, was praiseworthy. And we've got to understand that God spoke well of him. And when we do what we do, and we want to do things on God's level in a high quality manner, guess what? We got to want God's blessings. How many of you know that, guess what? I can tell you did a good job, but God knows what's in your heart. How many of you know that you can just deceive folk and mock and say, Lord, Jesus, the Lord was all upon you, but the Lord knew in the inside that, guess what, you ain't did about nothing. Why? Because guess what? God knows your heart. And I don't know about you, St. Mary, but I love your amens, and I love your thank you pastors, and I love your good jobs, and I love your good sermon. But at the end of the day, when I shut my eyes, I want God to say, servant, you done what I told you. Whether you tell me amen, good job, thank you, all night. Because I'm concerned about offering up what he's given to me in such a way to where he says, when I close my eyes, well done, thy good and thy faithful servant. My Lord. So I can't rely too much on what you tell me. I know, thank you for it. Every night again, it's encouraging. But guess what? When I know I'm doing what God wants me to do, and I know that God is shining down upon me, and when I know God has told me to do something, I act upon it, and when I know I preach a sermon that God wants me to preach, even when folks won't say amen, when I'm walking in his will, when I'm doing what he tells me, and when I do stuff to where, you know what, folk don't like it too much, guess what? If I know that God told me to do it, I'm going to do it anyway. Because why? At the end of the day, I want God to say and testify that he did what I told him. His worship is real. Ooh, Jesus. And how many of you want to say at the end of the day, at the end of your journey, that when you are said, when things are said and done, and when you take the long sleep, that guess what? God can look down upon you and look at your ministry and look at your life and say, yes, 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 you've been faithful. You've been faithful. And guess what? I know that you're real. And I know that you love me by what it is, not that you told me. Yeah, but what it is you was willing to give up for me. Why? Because my life no longer belongs to me. My life belongs to him. How many of you know, if you are blood-bought, you've been purchased. Yeah, if you show no blood-bought, you've been purchased with a price. See, it kind of reminds me of when folk, you know, join the services, join the armed forces. You see, when you join the armed forces, now I was never in there, but I heard a lot of stories, and some of those stories kind of discouraged me from even wanting to be in the first place. But I'm that way. But when you join the armed forces, guess what? Yeah, you are no longer yours. Uncle Sam going to give you what you need. Yeah, he's going to give you what you need to wear. He's going to provide for you where it is you're going to stay. And get what? Now you are Uncle Sam's property. And go ahead and try to leave if you want to leave on your own cognizance. Guess what? They're coming after you. Well, how many of you know that when God purchases you with a price, that guess what? He gives you what you need. He gives you what you're going to wear. He gives you and provides to you what it is that you need and what you're going to use throughout your daily living. So guess what? How in the world, how dare you take upon yourself as if you're your own man and you're your own woman?
All right. Jesus.
And we've got to understand that guess what? When we look at God and when we do what we do, we want God to say himself that we have done something honorable in his name.
Mm-hmm. Oh, yeah.
Because at the end of the day, at the end of the day, it doesn't matter what others say. Jesus. It doesn't matter about that. I've had times and times again where people say, preacher, you know, man, you know, you did an awesome job. Or they might ask me, preacher, how'd it go today? Or how was the sermon? And stuff like that. I'm like, man, say, I can't answer that. And they look at me, I'm like, why? I can't answer that. I said, let me tell you why I can't answer that. The only way I'm going to know if I did a good job on the surface and in what I can see is if folk heed to what God said and live their lives according to the word that I preach. Right. I can't watch them like a fly on the wall in their house. I can't follow them where they go. So guess what? I don't know if God's word went in and didn't go out or didn't do anything at all. You got to understand that we can't get so caught up in the praise of men. But we've got to know without a shadow of a doubt, be settled in our heart that, Lord, I know I'm in your will.
Yeah.
Ooh, Jesus, yeah. Jesus, yeah. Jesus, Jesus. Could you imagine Abel when he was given what it is that he gave and knowing that Cain, hadn't done what he was supposed to do and how Cain might have looked at him? And came out, gave him that shifty eye, as if Abel had done him something. All Abel did was do what God had asked him to do.
Right.
And here it is, came mad, jealous, and upset because he didn't do what he had been asked to do. Right. How many of you know that? Guess what? When you do God's business and you do God's work, there may be some conflict.
Right.
There may be some stuff that comes your way that you have to deal with that you didn't want to deal with. But that's what, when your praise comes from God, don't you dare worry. Guess what? It is God who will, guess what, put the stamp of approval on your works.
Oh, yes.
My Lord, I'm almost done. I'm going to the house. And look what it says at the end. It says, and by it, he being dead, Lord have mercy, yet speaketh. Yet speaketh. Yet speaketh. Yet speaketh. What he did took place at the beginning of time, but yet it's speaking. What he did took place way before we were even in existence, but yet it still speaks. We've got to understand that, guess what? When we worship God, when we live our life, when we do ministry, when we do stuff on God's behalf, we want to have to do it, or we want to be able to do it. Guess what? The way it speaks, even when it's over with. That folk can remember what it is that we've done. That folk can understand and know that, guess what? I know that it was God upon his life, God upon her life, moving and maneuvering in their lives to do what they did. Folk still speaking about some stuff that, guess what, happened way back in the cut. Why? Because it was an authentic worship. It was a high-quality worship. It was a worship that wasn't worried about other folk. It was a worship that was concerned about what God had told him to do. And when we live our lives with a lasting worship, with a worship that, guess what, will speak, then guess what? Our worship and our praise will go to a whole nother level.
All right. All right.
Ooh, Jesus. So when worship has high quality, we must understand and know that, number one, it will be sacrificial.
Oh, yeah.
Number two, it's going to expose the truth on the inside of you. it will be praiseworthy.
Amen.
And lastly, it will be a worship that will last.
Oh, yes.
It will stand the test of time.
Alright.
Yes. Here it is. We have a report about Abel, Cain, something that happened way back in the day.
Oh, yes.
And men, women, boy, and girl are still talking about it.
Oh, yes.
Amen.
Here it is. Abel gave an offering unto God, which is his first fruit. And God smiled down upon it and thought it good enough to put it in the Holy Bible.
Mm-hmm.
God wanted us to know about it. How many of you know that God put in his book what we need to know and what he wants us to know to
Amen.
Be able to give him the worship that is due unto us?
All right.
How many of us know that it's through God's word and what we know about him that about God. And because I know that in my life, that when I've asked for certain things, he's come through for me like nobody else. How many of you know that when you serve a God who can do something better than mama, better than daddy, better than mama, and better than papa, when you serve a God like that, guess what? You get up to offer your blessed assurance, and you get up off of your amens, and you will get up off of your hallelujahs, and you will give God some praise. I'm not done, but I quit. Amen.